Very good afternoon. Welcome, and thank you for joining us for today's free webinar, Enabling Effective Coatings Formulations to Improve the Durability of Assets, presented by Huntsman Advanced Materials. This webinar constitutes the first out of 3 series and is dedicated to tanks and pipes applications. I'm Sara Fernandez, European Operational Marketing Manager for the Coatings and Construction Industries, and it will be my pleasure to guide you through this live event today. At this point, please let me brief you on some house rules. This webinar will last approximately 45 minutes, split in 30 minutes for our presentation and 15 minutes for a question and answer period at the end. If you have a question, you might submit it at any time by using the WebEx Q&A tab on your screen. Please bear in mind to address your questions to all the panelists. We will answer as many questions as possible during the Q&A session. Those questions not addressed during the live event will be answered offline. After the webinar, you will receive the PDF file of the presentation by email. Please note that this webinar is being recorded and will be made available in a few days at the Huntsman website under the news/webinars section. Should you be immediately interested in a follow-up discussion, please contact us via WebEx chat during the webinar. Alternatively, you can submit your inquiries at the Huntsman website via the contact/advanced materials section or through our local sales representatives. Finally, we would much appreciate your participation to our survey at the end. Your feedback is essential to help us improve our next webinar sessions. At this time, I would like to introduce today's speakers. Dr. Alex Duro is our European Technology Manager for Huntsman Advanced Materials, taking care of the specialty components portfolio in aerospace, coating and construction, adhesives and composites applications. Mr. Duro has more than 15 years of expertise in the chemical industry. Mrs. Kerstin Strahlemeier works as Global Strategic Marketing Director for the coatings, construction and electronics industry for Advanced Materials, and she has held different roles related to the coatings applications for almost 30 years. Now that you are familiar with our speakers, let's begin today's presentation by starting with its content. Firstly, we will be opening with a brief introduction to durability, followed by its link to a special components provider like Huntsman Advanced Materials. After showing some science fundamentals, we will deepen into best practices to solve key challenges in high-performance coating formulations in the viscosity, brittleness, and degree of conversion features. Finally, we will conclude with a high-level summary and our solutions toolbox before we get into the Q&A session. So, let's get started by explaining why have we chosen durability for our coatings webinar series. As you may know, the tanks and pipes lining industry is under increased pressure on savings and productivity. Therefore, if you think about your current situation, you might be looking after improved durability of your coatings formulations in order to prolong the asset lifetime, extend the maintenance or inspections interval, reduce the level of repairing and its associated costs, or increase the asset productivity. So, let us help you with these burdens. Our speakers will explain in a few minutes why and how our component solutions enable improved heavy-duty formulations that offer outstanding levels of protection, bringing the durability performance that your customers are asking for. So, Kerstin, please, could you guide us through our implication as a specialty components provider in high-durable tanks and pipes lining formulation?
Thanks a lot, Sarah. Of course I can. So, durability for pipes and tanks, how do we translate that into our innovation platforms? Well, we have looked into critical attributes coatings would need to exhibit and translated that into the polymer design of our components. As you can see on this slide, we specifically paid attention to the glass transition temperature, toughness, mechanical strength, cross-linking density, curing kinetics, and hydrophobicity. In addition, we also had to take into account, of course, how the material is going to be applied. Is it shop applied versus field applied? How do you optimize application behavior and curing behavior? How to go about that? So as a result, we designed, as you can see on this slide, our components specifically in regard to TG, mechanical strength, toughness, cross-linking density, curing, and hydrophobicity. So what we will actually spend this seminar on is to look at the specific influence of polymer structure on coatings performance, plus some formulator challenges, some such as high viscosity, brittleness, and of course curing speed. So let's start with looking at the polymer design of epoxy resins and its impact on coatings performance. Alex, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Kerstin, and good afternoon, everybody, or good morning, depending where you are. So I start with the general structure of an epoxy resin, and the general structure is a structure of a bisphenol A epoxy resin, and that's a structure that people think about when they think about epoxy. What we can see on this structure is the high aromatic content. So aromatic are those small rings here, which leads to hydrophobicity and good thermomechanical properties. You can see on this structure also the presence of hydroxyl group, which help very much for the adhesion. And the ether group cannot be really hydrolyzed, unlike an ester function, which is also good for chemical resistance, let's say. So, if bisphenol A is actually the resin that everybody knows when we speak about epoxy, there is actually a very large number of epoxy available on the market, and you can see a few pictured here. To simplify, we try to define them with two important parameters, the aromaticity and the functionality. So what we can say is that the aromaticity strongly impacts the property of the resin. Basically, higher aromaticity level in a formulation leads to better thermomechanical properties, better chemical resistance, but also with higher viscosity. The higher functionality follow actually the same trend. So if high functionality combined with high aromaticity level seems to be the best in class, when you see chemical resistance, you generally have to pay the price in terms of viscosity and in terms of brittleness. So to summarize this slide, it's easy to improve aromaticity and functionality, and it leads to higher performance. But generally, two pain points come with it, viscosity and brittleness. This graphic explains why the resin or the hardener functionality has a clear impact on the cross-linking density, which lead to higher hardness and improved chemical resistance. You can see that difunctional plus difunctional will lead to a linear polymer. In the other hand, you can see that trifunctional plus tetrafunctional will lead to a dense tridimensional network, something like that also, which is what you seek for when you look for a barrier, let's say. The trade-off is that it diminishes the time to reach the gel point or the gelation and basically reduce your open time. That's the drawback. And it also impacts generally the viscosity of the single component before cure.
Right, Alex. So thanks a lot for that. So dense polymer structures with high functionalities give us durable performance, and viscosities might be rocketing high, so which is actually a huge challenge to the formulator. Can you maybe tell us a bit more on how we could manage that in a formulation? How can we handle viscosities better going forward?
Yeah, there is multiple way to deal with viscosity. The classic one is the use of an effective reactive diluent, and we will tackle that in a second part. But when we look at our resin portfolio, so here you have a part of our resin portfolio on this graph, we have plotted different different parameters. In the y-axis, you have the cross-linking density, and in the x-axis, you have the adhesion. The size of the bubble is basically proportional to the viscosity. It is first obvious that it's not trivial to get together the good adhesion and the good high cross-linking density that don't generally go together very well. We'll show later how to deal with adhesion and brittleness. Also, you can see that if GZ290, X90 gives some very interesting adhesion promotion, adhesion property, it's not the best in class regarding chemical resistance. It is also clear that if you look at just the EPN 1180, which is a great product, as it has a high viscosity, and the viscosity is about 130,000 millipascal second. And a good product to manage viscosity, avoiding the use of solvents, is actually this R-Extreme PY2100, and you have difficulty to see the bubble because it's a very low viscosity, but you see as well that it's the highest cross-linking density. So this product is of very high interest, and we are going to look at some feature of it. So to illustrate the special feature of this R-Extreme PY2100, it was compared, fully cured, with two high-temperature hardeners, so two different high-temperature hardeners, with other resin like GY250, which is a standard bisphenol A epoxy resin, like EPN 1179 or EPN 1180 R epoxy phenol novolac, and Araldite GY282, it's a bisphenol F epoxy resin. So what you can see on the left is clearly the trace of a DMTA, of the G prime versus temperature. And you can see that the R-Extreme, fully cured with a very high temperature hardener, give you a much higher modulus and also higher TG compared to the same experiment done with a standard bisphenol A, better modulus and higher TG. Now, when you look on the right side at the TG in the y-axis and the modulus in the x-axis, well, you see that the PY2100 is clearly the product which will give you the highest modulus and the highest glass transition. It's also cured here with a high-temperature cure hardener. What you can see is obviously the viscosity. Again, the point is you have difficulty to see it because the viscosity is only 700 millipascal second versus an EPN 1180, which is 130,000, an EPN 1179, which is about 40 to 50,000 millipascal second at room temperature. So, now, we look at an alternative way to reduce the viscosity, not using this aromatic low viscosity high cross-linking R-Extreme. We use the Araldite DY31, which is a high-performance diluent. This is a new tetrafunctional reactive diluent with a low viscosity combined with a high epoxy content. For example, you can see on the left that it enables, so you can see the DY31 here, it enables the reduction of viscosity of this EPN 1180 by adding a certain amount, which is about 40% here. You can go from 130,000 millipascal second to 10,000 millipascal second, which is basically similar to an Araldite GY250, a standard bisphenol A epoxy resin. But this reduction is quite huge, and the interest is that you don't really reduce the functionality because the EPN 1180 has a functionality of 3.6, while the DY31 is about 4, which means that at the end you are between 3 and 4, 3.6 and 4, which is still a very good high cross-linking density. On the right slide, you can look at the epoxy index versus in the y-axis and the TG in the x-axis, and those data, the TG is obtained by curing the single resin with a standard hardener, an IPDA-based hardener, Aradure 20315, and the size of the bubble is proportional to the water absorption 3 days in boiling water. What you can see is that the TG of DY31 is much higher than another standard difunctional reactive diluent, butanediol diglycidylether. It absorbs less water. Also, the epoxy index of butanediol diglycidylether is higher than DY31. The TG we obtain is about 135, which is way above the DYO26. DYC, which is a difunctional cycloaliphatic, has got a TG of 70 with less epoxy index. It gives some other interest, a good hydrophobicity, and a good flexibility. Now, if we compare DY31 with the standard bisphenol A epoxy resin, in this specific test, the TG of a bisphenol A epoxy resin will be around 150, and DY31 is only 15 degrees below this bisphenol A epoxy resin, which gives an idea why it is so special for reactive diluent, as the viscosity is only 300 millipascal second.
Thanks a lot, Alex. So to summarize, choosing the right epoxy resin in combination with a high-performing reactive diluent should help us to balance the viscosity and the workability of our polymer system. But as you also just said, we are talking about systems with very high glass transition temperatures. We have to take that into account. That also means that after curing, we have a very brittle film, which can crack easily and, as a result, loses durability. Is there a way to improve that?
I think so. We have seen that designing a matrix. We have seen that designing a matrix with a high cross-linking density and a good thermomechanical property is clearly possible. And it's true that it generally leads to brittleness. So we are presenting here a range of products that we call reactive liquid polymer. This is a general structure of this polymer. And basically, it's a random copolymer of butadiene and acrylonitrile. So it's a copolymer, polybut, polyacrylonitrile. And it's important to understand that each monomer has its purpose. So, for example, the butadiene, it is like natural rubber, so it's very flexible, very hydrophobic, has a very low TG, around minus 40. And the acrylonitrile will bring something else. It will bring some polarity, which helps for adhesion. It also increases glass transition, increase also viscosity, unfortunately. And it increases the adhesion, generally. This random polymer can be functionalized with a reactive end group, which can be an epoxy, an amine, or even a vinylic group. The addition of those reactive liquid polymer will strongly increase the toughness and slightly reduce the TG. And we generally say that there is a sweet spot between 5 and 15% of polymer content, of rubber content, so about 10%. Here, on this slide, is to illustrate how it works. In general, on the left side, a matrix has a continuous phase, only one. And as you can see on the graph on the left, there is an easy crack propagation. Using the reactive liquid rubber, it can allow you to have the generation of a second phase, which lead to the generation of this second phase will happen upon cure and will lead to the presence of nodules here, which are rubbery. Those rubbery nodules will absorb the energy of a crack, or absorb the crack, if you want, and that's what really helps to reduce the crack propagation. And on the right side, you can see under the microscope how it looks, how those rubbery nodules can look under the microscope. As mentioned, there is a large range of hypo, hypox with different functionality, amine, for ATBN, aminoterminated polybutadiene acrylonitrile, epox, which are epoxy functionalized, and there is a wide range of viscosity from a very relatively low viscosity at 20,000 millipascal second to a very high viscosity of 450,000 millipascal second. There is different functionality with less rubber as well. So, for example, the epox RF933 contain less rubber but have higher functionality because they are modified with a special epoxy, and they will bring some other advantage. So there is a large quantity of product. It's important, and you don't see it on the graph, why they are different. The product is because you can replay with the ratio between butadiene and acrylonitrile, and then you get different property, easier phase separation, better adhesion on metal, different property depending of different condition, and in general, we should be able to find the right system to the need. Reactive liquid rubber can be used to increase toughness. That's true while maintaining TG, but can also be used for improving adhesion, especially at very low temperature. And that's what you see on the left. We took a standard room temperature system, Aradur 140, a reactive polyamidoamine, with a standard bisphenol A epoxy resin. And this is a reference, so a reference in blue. And this is a typical system that can be used in coating or even in adhesive. And you can see that by adding 30% of these aminoterminated polybutadiene acrylonitrile into this product, you can increase the lab shear strength at low temperature, minus 40, so the adhesion basically, and also at room temperature. But it's also specifically with this special test TPL strength that you really improve tremendously the adhesion. Now, if you look at on the right, it's a different experiment where we use the epox RF928 into a bisphenol F epoxy resin cure with a high temperature epoxy. So the RF928 is a multifunctional. So what we can see is that by adding 45 or 65%, and we can see that 65% is definitely too much, but 45%, you really get a large increase of the G1C and a small decrease of the TG and of the strength. So what is G1C? G1C is the energy which is needed to propagate a crack. Obviously, if you need more energy, the crack is not propagating easily. So having an increase of G1C is great because the crack will not propagate. Something maybe which would have been interesting in this test is that to look at with only 20% how the data will look. In this case, epox 928, you could argue 45% is a lot, but actually 928 only contains 20% rubber. So when you think about it, it's about 10% in the total matrix, as we stated at the beginning.
So just to recap, this toughness, you can optimize the crack resistance of example a tank lining coating. But one of the questions which is going through my mind is that high cross-linking densities are not formed instantly after, let's say, a lining is applied. So how quickly can we reach the optimum performance of our coating? Is it hours or days? And what can we do to get the highest performance the fastest? Alex, again, any suggestions are welcome.
Yeah. It's really possible indeed to design a system which will lead to a high cross-linking density combined with high aromaticity. But a key parameter in any epoxy system when we speak about durability is the conversion. Basically, the conversion, what I mean is the degree of cure. It is common to say, and it's also true, that you will obtain a glass transition which is maximum 30 degrees C above your curing temperature. So to illustrate that, we did represent on the left graph the TG versus the conversion of a very high temperature system. So that's the blue line. And what we see is that if you cure this system at room temperature, which is, let's say, 25 degrees C, you will achieve a TG around 55-60, which you can see for the system would be only a conversion of 60%. And you can see that for this system, basically, if you really wanted to get the 180 degree TG potential of this system when fully cured, you actually need to cure at least at 150 degrees C. Because it's nice, you can design an ITG system, but if you only cure it up to 60%, it's actually a very bad system, because you don't want to have this system cure at room temperature, because basically with only 60% conversion, you will have a lot of unreacted amine and a lot of unreacted epoxy, and you really don't want to have that in your coating left alone. So basically, the TG objective should be linked with a curing condition, not forgetting an eventual post-cure in situ, which can help in some application. And the graph on the right illustrates that. So we have a system, a different system, where you have a potential TG of 85, let's say. And you need a curing temperature which is minimum 30 degrees below the TG, which means in this graph that you can see, with 60 degrees C cure, you could manage to get this 85 degrees, but with 40 degrees C, no, you could not. So it's really a fact that you need really to have this 30 degree, minimum 30 degree below the potential TG to achieve a very good conversion in a coating. But when it's not possible to cure at high temperature, you need to do other things. And what people do generally to manage to have a good conversion is that they add a plasticizer. So common plasticizer in some coating could be benzyl alcohol, for example. And here you can see a system with a maximum TG when fully cured evolve going down when you add some plasticizer. In the whole system here, when you start with a TG of 135, you add a plasticizer up to 16%, and you can see that your TG from 135 go down to only 75, which is not too bad. But at least you can also see that the conversion that you would obtain when you cure at room temperature would increase, meaning that if you cure at room temperature this system, you have only 75% conversion. If you add to the same system 16% plasticizer, you can manage a 95% conversion. You will not get maybe the 80 degree TG, but you will get a 95% conversion with most likely a TG of 55. So basically, system needs to be adapted to the situation, curing condition, constraint, and level of resistance. And it's also why we offer a large variety of curing agents. And I wanted also to say something about the plasticizer. Adding plasticizer is not good for chemical resistance, as a plasticizer can leach out. So this large variety of curing agents is represented here. But what I wanted to say first is that earlier we spoke about the resin, about the level of aromaticity and functionality, how it is important for the resin. I wanted to say first that it's the same for the curing agent. And we commonly say that it's easier to influence the performance of a system with the hardener or the curing agent. And why is that? The reason is that the hardener will drive the kinetics. So we have selected on this slide our curing agent for good chemical resistance. Among them, some are with plasticizer. It's actually a plasticizer, which is a VOC as well, but in fact, it doesn't evaporate. So some contain plasticizers, some do not. They are fast hardener, like Aradure 33641. There is some slower one. And if we look in another angle, looking at the chemical resistance performance and the adhesion, you can see that some product will bring better adhesion, but not necessarily the best chemical resistance. I would think that there is an hardener or at least a combination of them for each condition, curing, or level of resistance needed. So you really have to adapt your system to what you need to achieve. For example, Aradure 3064 would be great for chemical resistance, but some people might find it a bit slow. It is then possible to blend it with very reactive Aradure 33641 and to adjust reactivity to your need. If other wants to have an improved adhesion, then maybe Aradure 265 is the right compromise, as it will bring, as it will really improve the adhesion with a good chemical resistance. It also brings some plasticizer. So here again, we speak about optimization. We choose to present Aradure 3064. As it is the best in class for chemical resistance from a portfolio, it is clear. And this product is approved under Petrobras specification, this one, and the results, let's say, are summarized everywhere on this slide, and you can see the good resistance towards ethanol, for example, which is not so trivial generally. And you can see the outstanding performance, so the abrasion resistance, the good adhesion, and the result in the cells at 60 degrees, and it passed all the need of this Petrobras N2912. For low temperature cure, there is clearly always a need to accelerate the curing agent. Epoxy and amine generally don't cure very well without accelerator at low temperature. So the pain point when you accelerate a system is that in general, you reduce the pot life strongly. And it's also generally when you use an accelerator like here, you plasticize your matrix, your cross-link matrix, by having this accelerator which stand alone and which can leach out. This scheme represents that. Of course, here there is an epoxy resin to cure with the standard amine. But we wanted to propose here an alternative way by having a special amine, or let's say a special amine accelerator, which contains basically the accelerator in the backbone. So basically, this is this accelerator 2950, and you can see this one is functionalized with a reactive amine. So this special amine will react with the epoxy, and the accelerator will remain in the backbone, so it doesn't plasticize. What is the other advantage? Is that you do not reach, because you have a lower functionality, in fact, you do not reach a gel point too quickly as it is for a standard amine, which is double the functionality. Also, you do not plasticize your system, and you can see the result here illustrating that. So in orange, you have a standard amine with accelerator, so system 1 or 3 with two different mix ratio. And you can see that when you try the same type of experiment at the same mix ratio, so system 2 and 4, accelerator 2950, you can really have a longer pot life, which is positive, obviously, and also have a shorter drying time. So it's really a win-win completely to use accelerator 2950 compared to a very multifunctional amine with a plasticizer accelerator, I would say. So We spoke about 2950. I wanted to share some data. And on the left, we did a simple test to prove the lower leaching effect compared to a standard accelerator. So what we do is we take a standard bisphenol A epoxy resin, cure with Aradur 2315, which is an IPDA-based hardener. We fully cure it in a thin film. We crush it, and we try to extract anything out of the cured material with a SOX clay, with solvent and things like that, to see if something leaches out. From this reference, nothing leaches out, which is normal. Then we did the same, taking exactly the same matrix, but adding 7% of the accelerator 960-1. And if we could extract 7%, we would be here at 7% at the potential maximum amount of accelerator which could leach out. We could not extract 7%, but we extracted still more than 4%, which is basically 60% of what we added as accelerator, which leached out. For the accelerator 2950, we did exactly the same experiment in parallel. And in this case, we only could remove a bit. I mean, there is reason why. Still, a bit was able to go out, but it was only less than 10, well, about 10% which of the accelerator which leached out. On the right side, you can see why we use accelerator 2950 and how we did use it. So here you have an Aradur 3282-1, which is a pretty slow reactive polyamidoamide modified hardener, and you can see that the pot life is the gel time. Yeah, the pot life is pretty long, with almost 300 minutes, with a drying time at room temperature, which is 12 hours basically. And you see that by adding 5%, the gel time is reduced, that's for sure, but the drying time is also reduced. With only 5% at 5 degrees, there is no cure. You cannot expect enough cure at this temperature. But you can see that with 10% or 20%, then you can actually cure your hardener. And basically with 20% of the accelerator, which is about 7% in the standard matrix, you can actually cure a coating in 16 hours. Not maybe fast enough, but 16 hours to have a full cure time, full drying time, is quite good. And that's what I wanted to share with you regarding the accelerator 2950. And I think now it's time to summarize the key topics.
Yes. Thanks a lot, Alex. So in summary, so to formulate highly durable coatings for pipes and tanks, you need to consider several aspects. So first of all, you need to choose a resin which delivers high cross-linking density at the lowest possible viscosity. We also heard that by choosing the right curing agent or the combination of curing agents, you can enhance chemical resistance and also temperature resistance. And you can accelerate if needed, depending on the curing condition and the situation you find yourself in. If you need to manage the workability, the applicability, or in other words, also the viscosity better, you can consider a multifunctional diluent. And if you need to increase your film toughness as you deal with high TG systems, the incorporation of a toughener can help you to overcome the brittleness and to basically prevent cracks and chips. For more details with regard to our component toolbox for pipe and tank lining formulation, we actually summarized this slide as part of the pack. And of course, you can reach out to us at any time for any additional questions. So, but with that, I would actually like to hand over to the questions you had during the presentation.
A lot, Kerstin. And thank you, of course, Kerstin and Alex, for sharing with us such valuable insights. So, yeah, it's time to open up for questions. We are glad to see that we have a few of them. We might not have enough time, but as we said at the start, We will come back to you via email offline afterwards with the responses that might not have been answered live. So if you would allow us a couple of seconds, then we will try to pick up the first question. I think this one is for you, Alex. And it's about what would be our recommendation for a tank lining that would be exposed to high temperatures above 60 degrees and also a mix of ethanol and acids. So could you share with us what would be technically the recommendations on this?
Yes. I would for the hardener, I would go for the Aradio 3064. And if you need to get cure a bit faster, I would potentially accelerate with Aradio 33641. Regarding the resin, it depends what is how is the formulation, meaning solvent or not solvent. I mean, I see potential use of the RX stream PY 2100, maybe not 100% because that would be over design, but you could cut this PY 2100 with an epoxy phenol novolac like EPN 1180. Also, using the Y31 to adjust the viscosity is one way. And in principle, since you cure at room temperature, but there is an in-service temperature at 60 degrees, I understand there will be an automatic post-cure, so I will design the potential TG around we said 60 degrees, so around 90 to 100 degrees to get a maximum conversion in service. So maybe a very fast cure to B stage to have a dry to touch, but having a post cure in service, which will happen quite quickly at 60 degrees. And so I will do that. Yeah. Hope it answers the question.
Thanks a lot, Alex. Let's go to the next one. So it's also again about suggestions, and this time is to reach the optimal performance of the tougheners. Alex,
so,
could you please go on?
Yeah, well, it really depends what is expected and what are the constraints. I mean, the toughener, we've seen there is a there is large amount of viscosity available, and we know viscosity can be sometimes an issue. There is also a need to be able to have this phase separation, but just upon cure. If you have already the phase separation in your pot before cure, that's not going to be helpful because then you will have a difficulty to use the toughener. So you need a toughener which is miscible with either the epoxy or the amine, and you need to have the right one with the right ratio between polybutadiene and acrylonitrile to get the right phase separation upon cure. I would say in coating, according to me, the amino-terminated polybutadiene is a good one because you get a large amount of rubber. And also, you could formulate in the amine, which is easier to have at low viscosity compared to an epoxy. So I will go for that. But if, for example, the goal is really to maintain the TG as a base, the RF, the multifunctional toughener, RF 928 or 930 something, is definitely also a good way. But then you will need to add more. It's but you need to check by yourself for your system.
Okay, thanks a lot, Alex. So of course, please feel free to, in case the answers are not 100% fitting what you were expecting, feel free to come back to us through the Q&A tab. So let's go on to the next one. And this is about whether we could consider the cure in 2 times, meaning drying and post-curing later.
Yeah, that's
your view, Alex.
Yeah. This is something which we do. Well, not we, but that people do often, is that you get kind of what I call B stage or a pre-cure. So you have a cure with your curing agent. You are maybe only at 70% conversion, but you are dry to touch. You are dry to touch, and you are even more hard to scratch. And then you can take the pieces into an oven, for example. That's one way. Or you can have also in-service cure, meaning if it's a coating where you will have hot water at 80 degrees, you will have a post-cure because of the hot water. And if you have cured enough your coating, you will have a post-cure in-service and actually quite quickly. This is totally possible to do a cure at 2 levels in 2 times.
Great, thanks a lot, Alex. So we are aware that we are a bit behind of schedule, but since we have quite a lot of interesting questions, I would like to extend still 5 minutes from the original schedule. So next one on the list. What would be the lowest curing temperature you can reach with your curing systems?
I would say commonly epoxy is difficult to cure at low temperature, it's true, but it's really possible to cure at 5 degrees. 5 degrees is possible with the right accelerator or the right hardener. We did develop in the past the Arakul range, which really allow you that to cure at 5 degrees. But it is also true that when you reduce your temperature 5 degrees, the viscosity of your resin and hardener increase a lot. And for processability reason, more than really curing, you might need a bit of solvent. But you can, if you can live with 10% solvent or 20% solvent, it's really feasible to actually have a decent pot life at room temperature and a very good cure at 5 degrees. I would say for me, I'm not equipped to do in the freezer at minus 30, but I could try, but I don't think it would work. I think we might face a lot of other issues if we go below 0 degrees for an epoxy system. You might cure, you might feel like it's cure, and maybe when the temperature goes up, it finishes the cure. But we generally say 5 degrees.
Thanks, Alex. So since you were talking about solvents, I will go to the next one related to VOC and SVHC free formulations. So what would be our recommendation to formulate durable coatings without compromising sustainability? So, Alex.
What would be my recommendation? To formulate a durable coating.
To formulate, without compromising sustainability. So, meaning related to low zero VOC content. Exactly.
So, I mean, it's really for 5 degrees cure. I think it's very difficult to totally avoid the use of solvent. That's what I think. It might be possible, but practically, I think it's complicated. The use of reactive diluent like DY31 is really a good substitute to solvents because you will have something which will play a role of a solvent, but we will not evaporate. So in terms of sustainability, it's quite good. And also will co-react. So you will not damage your system like you do with a plasticizer. So in principle, having a durable film is already sustainable somehow, as you have you have to, you do not have you do not have to make it so much so often. But I would think yes, it's definitely possible today to really avoid the use of solvent by using reactive diluent, by using good resin of low viscosity.
Thanks, Alex.
I think it's a question. But
well, yeah. As I said before, in case anything is still unclear, I appreciate all the attendees, please, to come back again through the Q&A section. Let's allow still a couple of them before we close. So next one is related to hydrophobicity. So for a tank lining work, an important feature is absorption permeability of the lining system. Can you tell us if you have performed evaluations or your experience with these features? Alex.
For the Aradio 3064, there was a clearly evaluation of with the norm Petrobras. Regarding the different products we present, often they have been tested in standard tests. They are components, so it's not always it's a comparison. We try to compare often Apple with Apple, and I can say that polybutadiene is very hydrophobic. It's really flexible, but it's also hydrophobic, so that's an advantage. A standard epoxy resin is used definitely for hydrophobicity. So yeah, hydrophobicity is generally not an issue. The difficulty comes often with epoxy when people try to have something flexible and hydrophobic, and then it's not always so easy. There is some components who can do that, but yes, in terms of hydrophobicity, I think most of our components are pretty hydrophobic, yes, at least the one we presented today.
Thanks a lot, Alex. Very last one, please. What is the impact on thermal stability of CTPN additives? Please, Alex.
So the principle is not to add 50% of those CTBN additives. As I said, there is we say about 10% of rubber, it's like the sweet spot. So obviously you do not want to have this rubber to be in your continuous phase. So that's why you have those nodules. The fact you have those nodules means that you will have your continuous phase, which will give you the property of your material. So your thermomechanical property, meaning your TG, your modulus, will be mostly driven by your continuous phase. And you want only 10% because those nodules will be just here for the crack propagation. And in terms of chemical resistance, they will not improve, no. That would not be honest. But they will not damage too much because we are something on polybutadiene, which is also hydrophobic. And there is no much way to hydrolyze those products. So that's where I think you could, if you don't use a massive amount of those additives, you will not damage too much your thermomechanical property. And I think that's the main advantage of those. I see that people ask why epoxy would react if it undergo a phase separation. It will undergo a phase separation when it reacts also. So meaning at the end of each chain, you have an epoxy. And this epoxy can react with an amine. And that's the way it works. It will be, of course, at the interface of the nodules, but it will react. So it's covalently attached. And there is a phase separation. And that's really the trick of this crack propagation resistance and also to help the adhesion onto some surface. But I would say overall, no, it doesn't affect too much the general property. That's where we show that the TG doesn't drop so much, but your G1C, your crack propagation energy needed, increase.
Yeah. Just Alex, just maybe just one comment from my side, but I also believe that the addition of the RLP, so hypo-hypox, does not necessarily reduce the long-term thermal mechanical aspect. So these nodules do not deteriorate faster than the rest of the resin matrix is in. So the large resin matrix, the overall resin matrix, is the leading component for the long-term stability. Would you agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, again, it's only 10%. So on the long term, no. I mean, UV, of course, but those coatings are generally not exposed to UV. So that would be my only concern.
So thanks a lot. Unfortunately, we need to keep it here. We are slightly behind schedule, despite of the interesting talk, but we need to close it here for today. So we hope we could raise your interest, but again, as stated before, for any further follow-up discussions, please don't hesitate to get in contact with us via our local sales representatives or also at our Huntsman website through the advanced materials section. Of course, if you would like to stay up to date on our news, please follow us as well on social media. We would like to thank you all for your participation today. And before we conclude, please remember to take part in our survey. So thank you very much again for your time, and we look forward to seeing you all at our next durability webinar session. Stay safe all, and wish you a very nice rest of the day. Bye.
Bye-bye.